Britain's darkest hour, Winston Churchill promised us if we won the war, we would move into bright, sunlit uplands. After many false dawns, can we finally say this is Britain's railway's finest hour?
Since the end of the Second World War, our railways have seen the most dramatic changes. The steam locomotive, that living, breathing machine that symbolised the very heart of the railways for over a century, was replaced by the new diesels and electrics. The route network, which in 1945 had covered 19,500 miles of track, was cut to under 12,000 by 1973. And for nearly 50 years, the railways were publicly owned. For me, it's the most interesting chapter of railway history. Why? Because I've been part of it. In fact, if it wasn't for the railways, this angelic-looking character may well have ended up behind bars. This, then, is the story of my life in the railways.
So, this is where it all started for me, Leamington Spa. This is where my love of railways began. Although I was born in Coventry, which is only about 12 miles away, the trains that went past my house were goods engines. To get to Leamington Spa, I used to catch a train on a Saturday morning from Coventry about 7 o'clock and get off here. It used to be called Leamington Spa Avenue, and this was the concourse here. Now, I could stand here and I could hear all these trains in the distance shooting past and making lots of noise and carriages banging. Wasn't a lot going on here, in fact, nothing used to move for hours. And I could never work out what I was doing here. And then one day, you know what, I thought there must be something over there, so I got up on this wall. And wow, my life changed, because suddenly,
Great Western engine went shooting through Leamington Spa station. They were the most fabulous passenger express locomotives ever built. And to see one in all its glory, well, I'll never forget it.
It was immaculate. It had a copper chimney, a brass dome, and a big lion on the tender. British Railways. Amazing, really. And all from this wall.
And so began a lifelong love affair with trains. Actually, I was born in the very same year as British Railways, 1947. At the stroke of midnight on the 31st of December of that year, every engine driver across the country sounded their whistles. It wasn't just to celebrate the new year, but a new era. From that point, Britain's railways became state-owned. The war had knocked the stuffing out the railways. The track was in poor condition. The locomotives were worn out. And the workforce was exhausted. With the election of a Labour government after the war, nationalisation was seen as the way ahead. There was, of course, the thorny issue of compensation for the shareholders of the original four railway companies. But they did actually get £1 billion from the government. That's a fair price in my book.
In 1947, the government set up what was known as the British Transport Commission. This, for the first time, nationalised canals, docks, railways, road transport and buses. They thought they'd build an integrated transport system. The railways were delighted. At last, a level playing field. Well, so they thought.
The trouble was that even under a Labour government, the railways were not a high priority. They were more interested in the creation of the National Health Service and a welfare state than running trains on time. Also, although the war had damaged the infrastructure, it had not destroyed it. Compared to, say, continental Europe, where the network was virtually wiped out, our railways got off relatively lightly. So the government was able to get away with a policy of make do and mend. The result? It took 10 long years to repair the war damage. In 1955, we had a workforce of over 500,000 running a fast network that had been built in the Victorian era, which meant we were maintaining thousands of miles of track and keeping alive a fleet of 18,000 steam locomotives. The one thing about steam locomotives is they are phenomenally labour-intensive and expensive to run.
The cost of running steam engines was enormous. It took 6 men just to literally put this engine away at the end of the day, because you've got to flatten the fire, clean the firebox, clean the smoke box, oil it up and leave it. You can't walk away from a steam engine.
And just when you think you've done, there's a small matter of clearing out the smoke box at the front. The worst job. Hot ash that gets sucked along the boiler tubes ends up here. And yep, you've guessed it, Muggins here has the job of clearing out every bit of it.
Gotta remember, there's a roaring great fire at the end of that. I've just been to Glasgow and back. It's all in my feet, in my eyes. Not a lot of fun this bit. Back in the 50s, 30s and 40s, the drivers used to drink about 11 pints before they even bothered to do this. Probably the only way you could get through this. I'm off for a pint myself now. Got to be an easier way of making a living than this. I think I might nip off and write a song.
So in the 1950s, we were running a 19th century railway in the middle of the 20th century. Change was needed, and it was going to come faster than anybody had imagined. In 1955, the British Transport Commission discovered to their horror that the railway's finances were far worse than anticipated. And mechanised mining now meant that coal was being produced, which was little better than dust. Steam engines need big lumps of coal to burn efficiently. The steam locomotive was becoming a liability. As a young lad, I had no idea that there were about to be such sweeping changes. It's just as well, as I was a committed steam fanatic.
During those 50s school holidays, this was an amazing place to be. Me and my mate Tommy Rowley, he made the worst jam sandwiches and always had a bag full of me, he had a suitcase full of jam sandwiches. And I hated jam sandwiches before I used to get starving. And the creme de la creme of locos would go through here. It was unbelievable. And the drivers would always wave at you and you occasionally go on the footplate. No wonder I became a railway man. It was fantastic. Tommy, what's that number?
In 1955, a grand scheme that would revolutionise the railways was unveiled. It was called the Modernisation Plan. £1,240,000,000 was to be invested over a 15-year period. Steam would give way to diesel and electrification. There would be extensive track renewals and resignalling. At last, a massive cash injection to regenerate our ailing railways. Except the plan was hopelessly optimistic. We took drivers from steam engines, didn't train them, and overnight put them straight onto diesels. We introduced hundreds of diesels that hadn't even been properly tested. Within 10 years, most of them were scrapped. The switch over to diesel power was a disaster. And if that wasn't bad enough, the electrification of the network went belly up too. The West Coast Main Line from Euston to Glasgow was completed, but it took nearly 20 years and the budget went through the roof. As a result, practically every other electrification scheme was cancelled. There was one bright spot on the horizon. You've guessed it, me. It's 1961 and my glittering career in the railways is about to kick off. I've come to the Churnet Valley Railway in Staffordshire. It's like time stood still here for 40 years. And it's just how I remember the railways when I started. Mind you, I was lucky to get a job at all, you see. When I was 15, well, I had a bit of a run-in with the local constabulary. Now, most people get their jobs by going for interviews, or, you know, applying for it. I got my job on the railway in a slightly unusual manner. In fact, I got nicked by the railway for stealing little bits, well, receiving, actually. And the judge thought I did such a wonderful job on these artifacts, he gave me 6 months probation making tea for the lads at Wolverhampton. And he gave me a free pass so I could travel on the train. Bit like putting me in a sweet shop, really. Anyway, when I'd done 6 months, one of the foremen said to me, "Do you fancy a job here?" I thought, this is the life for me. This is the sort of engine that I started on. 5700 class pannier tank. And the first thing you've got to learn is how to oil it up. As you can see, these corks are where the oil's kept in. Unfortunately, you've got oil pots in there as well. Now, at 15 years old, I was a bit thinner, so I could actually get in there and oil up.
Now, it's not just a case of having an oiling can and going round and splatting a bit here and a bit there. This is a skilled job, and it's important to get it right.
There's more than one sort of oil on a steam locomotive, because obviously, when it comes to areas where it's hot, you want oil that evaporates slower. So, you know, the driver would give you oiling can, he'd tell you what parts to oil, which oils to use. You do that. Takes you about 25, 30 minutes. Then you've got to go on these things. These are the sandboxes. You've got to make sure you've got sand in there. I'll tell you what, on a cold morning, by Christ, it was our job. It might have only been a little engine, but back up the first day on the railway for me, it could have been the Flying Scotsman. It was fantastic. It was so exciting. Climbing up here in my uniform, saying hello to the driver, and realising at last I was working on the railway.
Back then, British Rail was so short of labour, we ended up doing everything. Stoking, oiling, cleaning, or you name it, we had to do it. I had heard it took railwaymen 20 years to learn a trade, but we were needed so badly in those days, they just chucked us on the footplate as quickly as we could lift a shovel. It's fair to say that for 2 years I couldn't have been happier in my work. I was looking forward to being promoted up to a driver, but then BR went and ruined it all. They scrapped all the steam engines in my yard. I was left with an agonising choice.
The age of steam. For most of us, it's a distant, evocative memory. Until now, Hornby have developed the technology to bring you live steam in 00-gauge working models. This is real working steam, which needs skill to drive the train. Steam is generated and superheated by a miniature immersion heater. An onboard control system regulates the workings, but the real control is in the hands of the operator. Thanks to Hornby, this truly will be the age of the train.
Before you buy car insurance from just anyone, just keep asking yourself one question. Could I get a better deal with the AA? Because last year the AA could have saved you up to £199 on your car insurance. Why not see what you could save? Before you buy car insurance from just anyone, just ask. Call 0800 294 7777 or buy online.
We see children learning. And visions becoming reality. We see one patient, many experts, and developers discovering the next big thing. We see your potential. We're inspired to create software that helps you reach it.
One is the loneliest number that you'll ever do. Two can be as bad as one. It's the loneliest number since the number one.
You've got 1.3 million members behind you when you need them. Join us in unison.
We, the jury, find the defendant guilty as charged.
This is not a prison. No applause, no applause. It's other than that.
The child was detained single-handedly a wild Mustang.
What's he doing?
You let him go, you bring him back.
So where do I start? Plant a penny?
Plenty of water. Shazam, I've got me a money tree.
No. You gotta follow it up. Use the right tools. Guy I knew was a bona fide arborist.
What?
Oh, never mind. Let's just say he had every gizmo going. You had a job, needed a certain tool, bingo, he had it. And he never fobbed you off with long-handled secateurs, and what you needed was a vine lopper.
Well, if it's down to the tools, that's easy. I could grow me a money tree. I had the right tools.
You think so? Wrench in a tub of grease doesn't make you an engineer, you know.
Our expertise helps you choose the right investment tools. Barclays, fluent in finance.
At QuickFit, tyres are down again. Save 25% on four Continental tyres. And 60% on thousands of exhausts. QuickFit, keeping tyre and exhaust prices down.
Identity fraud, the fastest growing crime in Britain.
Hello, I'm Mrs. Walker.
Eileen Hannah.
This is Catherine McCuffin.
They'll steal your name.
Does that make you feel terrible, knowing that they've used your name?
They'll steal your money. They'll even steal your life. Stealing Lives, Tuesday at 10 on 4.
By 1964, my yard at Wolverhampton had phased out all the steam engines. These locomotives were the whole reason for me joining the railways. I had to leave. So I went off to try my hand in the music business. I should be so lucky. And this is what replaced my beloved steam engines, the diesels, which is why I left. Literally, you turn up, put the key in, pip the horn, and you're off. Ah! Oh yeah. Of course, I missed lesson one, how to put it in forward gear. You know, looking back, I sort of regret leaving the railways when I did. If I'd have stayed, I'd have sat behind the wheel of one of these monsters, the Deltic. This space age looking machine was built by the English Electric Company in 1954. With its 3,300 horsepower engine, it was the most powerful diesel engine in the world. This engine could run at 100 miles an hour all day. An amazing feat for the mid-50s. It also looked like nothing else out there. More American in style than anything we'd ever built before. That headlamp in the middle and its yellow chevron stripes. We called them cat's whiskers. I remember standing on the platform watching it go by. As it came thundering through, you had to stand right back. It was so awesome. you felt like you'd get sucked underneath it. The Deltics were introduced on the East Coast Main Line from King's Cross to York and Edinburgh as a cheaper alternative to electrification. Although only 22 were built, they ran until 1978. By the early 60s, we had reduced the fleet of steam locomotives from over 20,000 at their peak to 7,000. There were now over 2,000 diesels operating on the main line, along with another 2,000 diesel units trundling up and down the branch lines. Ah, the branch lines. The railways may have started to modernise, but we still have thousands of miles of track to maintain. One man was about to change all that, but in doing so, he would become public enemy number one. By 1963, it was obvious that the modernisation plan had not stopped the railway rot. The network was losing passengers and freight to the roads and struggling to maintain the vast network of lines and stations. In a dramatic move, the government appointed an outsider to chair the newly formed British Railways Board. His name was Dr. Richard Beeching. You may know him better as the man who savagely wielded the Beeching axe, but in my humble opinion, he's one of the railway's great heroes. Beeching joined the railway from ICI, and the first thing he did was demand the same salary, £28,000 a year. This, by railway standards, was huge and outraged the whole industry. But the government wanted their man and paid him. And so began the first real review of railway finances. It seems a bit odd to want to hire somebody who knew nothing about railways to be chairman. So I went to see Professor Colin Duval, a historian at York University, to find out why.
The government had decided that the railways were in dire need of a shake-up, radical change. But I don't think that there was a great deal of belief that people who had been brought up within the industry had the willpower, if you like, to carry through the sort of radical surgery, the kind of radical change that the government of the day clearly believed was necessary.
Amazingly, before Beeching set to work, no one had had a clue where the money was being lost or made. He found that just half the network carried 95% of its traffic. The most successful part of the system was the long-distance city-to-city routes. As for the rest, the picture was far worse. Most of the branch lines were losing money hand over fist. The commuter lines, although full to the brim in the rush hour, were practically empty the rest of the day. Beeching's explosive report proposed the closure of 2,363 stations. That's nearly a third of the network. It would mean shutting down 5,000 route miles of track. There was an uproar. But some of these rural services were so underused, it was costing unbelievable sums to run them. It would have been cheaper to ferry every passenger around in taxis or buy them each a car. When the axe fell, it was brutal. Cross-country lines and even some main lines disappeared, and areas of the West Country, Scotland and Wales became railway deserts. This is Oswestry Street in Shropshire on the Welsh borders. Once upon a time, this was a major station with connections to London, Birmingham and the West Country. I've come to meet Brian Rowe, an ex-BR fireman, who was based here, to find out what happened when the railway shut down.
What did that do to the community?
Oh, it devastated it. We've never recovered. Because not only did we have a lovely railway running here, we had, of course, the facility inside the works. Repaired wagons, coaches, and of course locomotives were repaired inside there. And a lot of guys worked inside there. And I don't think we ever recovered from there. I mean, that beautiful building behind us, built in 1866, headquarters of the Cambrian Railways, can one say?
Just look at that building.
It's impressive.
There's a statement to bankruptcy. Anything you English can do, we Welsh can do better. I mean, that is a beautiful building. I mean, that's fantastic.
So the bottom line was, before it closed, which everybody tends to forget the truth, actually how many people were travelling on the railway here?
Very few, unfortunately. And I think that caused the demise of it all, didn't it, really?
Yeah, it did.
At the end of the day, I mean, as I say, I worked on the railway here for 12 years as a fireman, and we'd have three or four coaches behind us going to Witchers, perhaps, with, what, half a dozen people on it? And that caused it all. And the branch lines were even worse, of course. It's very, very sad when you think about it.
As well as the cuts, beaching had also sped up the withdrawal of steam. In August 1968, BR announced that British Rail had run out of steam. By that date, 16,000 steam engines had been sent to the scrapyard, a sad end for such a noble beast. For over 150 years, the steam engine had reigned supreme. This was the machine that changed the world, the end of a remarkable era. Dr. Beeching didn't get it all his own way. Members of Parliament, desperate to hold on to their seats, made sure the axe wasn't swung in their areas, so the savings were nothing like Beeching had wanted. Eventually, 2,000 stations were shut down and 4,000 miles of track closed. In the end, BR only saved £28 million a year, a relatively small sum in railway terms. Even though most people only remember the Beeching axe, he was a visionary. Beeching rightly saw the best way to make money was to run a modern high-speed intercity service that could rival a car.
Now, it's easy standing here looking back in time and saying that if you get rid of the bits that don't make money and you develop the pieces that do make money, you've got a wonderful railway system. But Beeching wasn't from a railway background. And to say that to railwaymen in 1962 was quite revolutionary.
The public image of Beeching today is still the man who swung the axe over lots of lightly used rural railways and country stations, but there was that more positive side to him. So a fairer, more balanced picture of Beeching would be Beeching the axe man, but also Beeching the saviour of the railway and the man who promoted the modern railway as a system of fast passenger trains and long distance heavy haul freight.
And this is what brought Beeching's vision to life, the Intercity 125, or high-speed train. The promise of regular, fast intercity trains speeding across the country was no longer a dream. Its cruising speed of 125 miles an hour makes it the world's fastest diesel, and for me, you can keep your Eurostars and your TGVs, it's the best train ever built. In fact, it's every bit as much a classic as the Flying Scotsman. Shame about the doors, though.
In 75, British Railways had a bit of a problem. They'd electrified the West Coast main line, but still, basically 80% of British Railways had no electrification, with no hope of getting the money out of the government. So it introduced its ace, its trump card, the HST. 125 miles an hour for a diesel train, a world record. Engine at one end, engine at the other. Mark III coaches, a whole new design. They were magnificent. They were fantastic. In 2003, they're as good as when they were introduced. They allowed me to commute to London in an hour, which meant I didn't have to buy an expensive house in the capital. I could still live in the Midlands. Fantastic, well done, BR.
The HST went into service in 1976 and was an instant success. But at the time, it was only meant to act as a stopgap for something far more radical.
This hinges on the final one. So this one correct, your prediction was right. Heads or tails?
Tails.
You're right.
Right, I'm good.
Fantastic. All right, how did you do that?
I'm good,
yeah.
Come on.
So now I'm getting excited about the casino.
There you go, that's the whole idea. Come on, we'll play a couple of more of these games till we get to the crap tables, then you take it out your wallet.
The ING Direct Savings Account gives everyone the same high rate of 5%. It's easy. Go online and you can open an account in minutes. Or on the phone. That's why we're the world's leading direct savings bank. And your money's free to move in or out whenever you like. And there really are no catches. Call now or go online. ING Direct. It's your money we're saving.
Who are the greatest artists of the 80s? UK Music Hall of Fame, tonight at 9 on 4.
Today the high-speed train is such a common sight, we hardly even notice it. But next time you see one, take a closer look. It really is a magnificent machine. Before the introduction in 1976 of the HST, journey times had hardly changed for years. And then overnight, the HST slashed times between the big cities. London to Bristol was cut by 15 minutes to 70 minutes. And London to Edinburgh was reduced by an hour to 4.5. Over the last 10 years, I've been lucky enough to do most routes on the old British Rail network. But I've never, ever travelled out to Sheffield, and I've never, ever travelled in the cab of an HST. So I know they don't put any coal in here, but I'm going to sit with the driver. This is a treat, isn't it? Good old Channel 4. How are you? All right. Good. Do you know, I was so excited I could hardly speak. Well, not straight away, anyway. Hey, well, you don't realise how much of a hill that was till you see how long this is going down, do you?
That's right. It's a struggle when you're only on one power car.
Oh, I bet.
This one we're just coming up to now, this is the automatic warning system for the ramp, which will ring a bell in the cab as the signal is green.
There you go.
You don't need to acknowledge that one, because it's only confirming that it's a green aspect.
Yeah.
When you hear the AWS horn, you have to respond to that within 4 or 5 seconds, otherwise it will cut the power off and put the brake on and stop the train for you.
Now you might think this is easy, but it's not as easy as you actually think. These guys have to know every inch of the track, and they have to sign for it that they know it, because you need to know when there's a hill to accelerate, when you're going downhill to decelerate, tunnels, signals, crossovers, speed limits. It is hard concentration, listening for the bells and the whistles and the horns, cancelling them, remembering to cancel them, watch for the signals. And of course it's worse at night, because at night you can mistake the lights on the railway for traffic lights. So that's why route knowledge that these guys learn is vastly important. That's another few miles of me route knowledge.
Good.
Updated.
Are you ready to sign for it then, please?
No, not quite, but I can say I've done it. That's enough in my book. Probably never do it again in my lifetime. Listen, pleasure. Thanks very much
nice
indeed.
Enjoyed it.
Thank you. Now don't laugh, but the HST did one other thing. It transformed onboard catering. You probably won't be surprised to hear that under BR, apart from some of its premier business services, train catering was not up to much. But then back in the early 70s, I seem to remember, British eating habits were a bit of a joke anyway. And then along came the HST with a catering car on every train. In 1976, you could have had your choice of pizza, steak and kidney pie, or even a ham salad. Or you could treat yourself and sit in the restaurant car and enjoy luncheon or high tea. And while we're on the subject, how could we make a film about BR without mentioning that classic, the Great British Rail Sandwich?
I've heard a lot about the Royal Train, I think it will be sad.
I've managed to get Chef Terry Foster, who's been on the railway since 1957, to let us in on a little secret.
Right, Terry, let's have a look at a ham sandwich.
like we used to do.
Yeah, please.
Now, what Terry's about to show you is a trick that fooled us all for years.
Very nice. Slice it up. I noticed you put two slices on there, Terry. That being a bit generous.
That's only one there.
Oh, that's it. Well, thank God for that, yeah.
Now, we used to put, like, half of that in half. But it's okay. Make it
look a bit thicker.
Yeah, you used to make it look nice then.
Right.
And as if by magic, half a slice of ham looks like a whole slice.
And we just send them out.
It works, it actually looks like it's two pieces of ham in there. Very clever.
The poor old British Rail sandwich took a load of flak, but they must have been doing something right. In 1 year alone, over 8 million packs of sandwiches were sold. I dread to think how many of those I ate.
That's the best thing about riding on trains. You can eat, it's civil. It's not like being on a plane where it's plastic food, it's real food on here. Fantastic. 30 years has done nothing for my health.
Amazingly, the HST was only meant to be a temporary fix until this, the Advanced Passenger Train, or APT, was ready to take to the rails. The APT was going to be British Rail's flagship, something the rest of the world would look at in envy. Instead, it turned into one of their biggest disasters. Back in the 1960s, British Railways needed to drastically speed up journey times on the intercity routes to compete with the car and the domestic airlines. But there was a problem. The busiest route on the network, the West Coast Main Line from Euston to Glasgow, is also one of the slowest. It has lots of curves. To travel at really high speeds, the track would have to be ripped up and new straight lines laid. But the cost of building a new line would be astronomical. As a result, the British Rail Board came up with the APT. This train could run on existing tracks at speeds of over 160 miles an hour. I met up with the original project director, Professor Alan Wickens.
The railways at that time were gradually recognising that high speeds on intercity routes attracted more passengers. And particularly in Japan, for example, they opened a new high-speed railway. In this country, it was obviously impossible to build new railways. So the idea was to build a high-speed train which would run on existing tracks and with existing signalling.
But how can you even think of running a train at such high speeds on our clapped-out old tracks?
Essentially, you do what a motorbike rider does. He tilts on the bends and he doesn't have to slow down at the bends. We designed a powered tilting system which actually force the body to tilt on a curve in exactly the same way as the motorcycle rider does.
Now, if you think that tilting a train sounds high-tech and unrailway-like, you'd be right. The APT was designed by bright young things, engineers who came from the aerospace and motoring industry. The first experimental train proved a tilting train could run at high speed on existing track. But the next phase of the project is where all the problems began.
Now, in the case of APTP, the prototype trains, there were delays in building the trains. So there was considerable pressure to see it in service and to try it out. And unfortunately, that meant that it was really put into an experimental service prematurely when there were still some bugs in it.
So how do you get the maximum publicity for one of these new trains? Well, you fill it full of journalists, give them plenty of alcoholic beverages, then you tilt it, and then you break down. The journalists are sick, the train's not going anywhere, bingo, maximum publicity. Not quite the publicity you want, though.
Now, I know that it was in front of an invited audience, but it's very difficult to keep a train away from the public gaze anyway. Think about it. When a car manufacturer tests a new car, it's done in complete secrecy on a private road, away from the glare of publicity. Well, you can't really do that with a train, so all the problems are on show all the time. And as always with the railways, the project suffered from some poor management and was run on a pretty low budget.
The money involved in APT was incredibly small, really. The total cost of the project was less than £50 million. And that included building some depots and things like that, which are in use today. Now, at the same time, Concord cost £2 billion. So it would not have been unreasonable to put a bit more money into railway development.
The APT limped on until 1985, when it was finally withdrawn from service. So after all the embarrassments, the only thing that BR could do was to get rid of it. For a while, the National Railway Museum in York looked after it. When it was offered to us at the Crewe Railway Heritage Trust, I, as the chairman, jumped at the chance to give it a home. I know it's not going anywhere, but at least people can get a glimpse of the world's first tilting train. British Railways, oh so nearly train. But the APT project wasn't all for nothing. The HST owes a large part of its success to the groundbreaking work of the APT designers.
The HST did take quite a lot from the basic research that had made the APT possible. The fundamental work involved the development of new suspension systems and an understanding of how the wheel and the rail interacted one with another. Until the early 1960s, nobody really believed that you could run a train in everyday service at much over 100 miles per hour. It was thought that the train would be too unstable, certainly too uncomfortable for passengers to ride in over any distance at all. But work that was done by the research team who were responsible for APT demonstrated that with the right kind of suspension system, you could run at much, much higher speeds without damaging the track and without making passengers feel uncomfortable. And that kind of work fed directly into the HST project.
Without the HST, the railways would have lost out totally to cars, coaches and even airlines. But in the long run, the HST couldn't save British Rail itself. The state-run company continued to run the railways for the next 18 years, but each year with less and less government subsidy. The writing was on the wall for BR.
Come on, we're here. Lucky!
Quick, the door.
There he goes, Dad.
Don't panic. If you're a safe driver, More Than lets you protect your maximum no claim discount for life, which means your premium will never go up.
Dad!
Woohoo! Just because you've made a claim.
That's lucky.
And you can save up to 40% when you switch.
That's more than lucky.
Call More Than now on 0800 300 202 and you can save up to 40% when you switch.
Ciao, Sophia.
Oops, sorry.
Niente.
Sorry.
In Italy, different flowers have different meanings. Chrysanthemums, for example, are associated with funerals and sadness.
Sophia Marta!
At HSBC, we never underestimate the importance of local knowledge. HSBC, the world's local bank.
The complete history of the monarchy told in a major television event.
It's over 1,500 years old, which means it's the oldest functioning political institution in Europe.
Monarchy by David Starkey. An epic 20-part series to be broadcast over 4 years begins Monday at 9 on 4.
You're probably wondering what's happened to me in the story of British Rail. Well, over the years, I did buy up a few old BR steam engines and a few diesels too. But by the end of the 80s, I really wanted to get back into the railways. So I put my money where my mouth was and invested in the future of the railways as soon as I could. In January 1993, the Conservative government privatised the nation's railways. And if you ask me, it was the best thing that could have happened. By the 90s, the railways needed a new look, a new idea, freshness, innovations, enthusiasm, actually people that actually believed in railways. The government had lost faith. The railways needed a huge injection of cash. It wasn't coming for the government.
It had to come from somewhere else. It had to come from the private sector.
So nearly 30 years after leaving British Rail, I return to my roots. I now operate a railway engineering and maintenance company here at Crewe. Now, you may think that today the service is much worse than it was, that it's far more dangerous, and that it's fallen to pieces. But that's just not true. I reckon our trains today are pretty amazing. The East Coast Main Line service to Edinburgh has more trains than ever. There are more cross-country routes and passenger numbers are up. And the investment in new rolling stock has been far greater than under BR. I agree there has been problems with privatisation, but most of these problems already existed. Anyway, no matter how bad you think it is, it still beats the car.
Making this series, I've learnt a very valuable lesson. I don't live in the real world. And I say I don't live in the real world for one simple reason. I don't commute by car, and I never have. For 32 years of my life, I've used trains nearly every day, and still do. Because during this series, I've had to commute to some of the shoots at 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning, and I've had to experience, for the first time in my life, motorway congestion. Why would any of you want to commute by car that takes me an hour, must take you three? Baffles me. Thank God I don't live in the real world.
And why go by car when you can travel on one of these fabulous new trains? Guess what? The Tilton train is making a comeback. This is the son of APT, the Pendolino. Over 30 years after the APT, it's taken engineers from Italy to finally sort out its tilting mechanism. The APT's big problem was that when it went round corners, the passengers didn't feel the motion of the train. The designers had engineered it out. This was why people felt sick. What they were sensing in the carriage didn't relate to what they saw out the window. The great thing about the Pendolino is, when this train corners at high speed, you feel the movement. Only slightly, but enough to stop the brain from being confused. And today I'm getting my chance to drive one of these trains. Well, actually it's a simulator, but it looks and feels like the real thing. Mind you, it should do. It costs £3 million. With all these computer screens and bells and whistles, it looks more like the flight deck to me than a driver's cab.
The cabs are very, very lifelike. They're exact replicas of the trains which are out there in service. It's based actually on routes. The drivers will probably drive over themselves. For the West Coast Pendolino simulator, it's modelled from Nuneaton up to Stafford and back again. The cabs themselves operate and function just like the real cabs do. And that gives the driver a heads up right away in a safe environment. And when they actually do get to going out with a driving instructor on the real train for the first time, they'll know where everything is. They'll know what the sound's like for certain buzzers, certain bells, and they've applied the rules and regulations on the simulators before they go in the real world. So it really is a good thing for the drivers of the future.
And just as I thought I'd cracked it, the instructors threw a few spanners in the works.
Tilting here.
Give them two back. Putting Pete through it here. Press that yellow one there, Pete. And we want to press this one here as well.
I was doing just fine, honest. Until some other buzzers went off and the train's brakes came on.
Someone's pulled the pass con.
All right.
Okay.
You only get a couple of seconds to cancel an alarm when all the buttons look the same.
Somebody's setting us up here.
Didn't realise it was set.
That one, Pete. Oh, you're just in time. I think, no, you weren't. Look, train protection warning system has come in. Because you didn't cancel the automatic warning system in 2.5 seconds, an emergency brake application was provided.
That's unfair. That was cheating. I was doing that up there. Did that feel like 2.5 seconds?
It takes 12 months to train the driver up, and I've only had an hour. Well, I did manage to get to the end of the line in the simulator eventually. I wonder if I've made the grade.
Well, not quite yet, Pete. I think you've got to come back and do a little bit more, especially in relation to our Mersey Brake Override and AWS, you did get a little bit flustered there once or twice, but we got you right in the end.
The Pendolino is now in service, and after years of neglect and despair on the West Coast Main Line, Britain's railways finally have 125 miles an hour tilting train service between London and Manchester. And eventually the service is planned to run at 140 miles an hour. But that's still slower than the speeds the APT achieved 30 years ago. But let's not spoil the party. So, do we finally have a railway we can be proud of? Well, as BR used to say, we're getting there. But it's not going to happen overnight. Remember, it's been 100 years since the last mainline tracks were laid in this country. But I do feel optimistic. Right now, 100 years later, one of the biggest railway engineering projects in our history is underway. If you'd have told me when I was a lad you could travel by train from London to Paris, have lunch and be back in time for tea, I'd have laughed in your face. But that's the great thing about railways, they still have the power to change our lives. This is the Channel Tunnel Rail Link. The 68 miles of high-speed track will run from St Pancras Station in London to the tunnel entrance at Folkestone. It's the most breathtaking engineering project I've ever seen. They're building five tunnels. One 13-mile stretch of tunnel is going right under London. There are 152 bridges along the route. They've moved listed buildings, dismantling them and re-erecting them. And take a look at this. They picked one old building up and moved it in one piece. It's going to cost over £5 billion. But when it's completed in 2007, London to Paris will be just 2 hours, 20 minutes. That's money well spent if you ask me. Instead of dawdling through the suburbs on its way to the Channel Tunnel, the Eurostar will be able to leave St Pancras and within minutes be hurtling along at over 180 miles an hour. The fastest train in the world, finally able to travel at top speed in this country. Nearly two centuries after Stevenson's rocket launched a transport revolution, I wonder if now we're about to see another revolution in train travel. But this time we're talking about a rail network that can link us to all parts of Europe, proving that the only way to travel is by train. I hope so, I really do.
It was the railway, which in the 19th century, well into the 20th century, was the backbone of the transport system that we have, which contributed to the huge economic development and also the social changes that went along with that. The railway didn't cause any of these things, but without the railway, it's impossible to imagine modern-day Britain.
And as for me, I suppose you could say I've come full circle, from dodging prison by making tea in a railway yard to owning my own railway engineering company. I look after and repair old steam locomotives that would otherwise just rust away. In fact, if I've got any spare time, you'll probably find me tinkering about with one of these things. And I wouldn't have it any other way. But you know, there's one thing I've always wanted since I was a child. Throughout the last 55 years of my life, I've wanted to build a model railway. Every year I'm going to build it next year. Well, this year I've finally started. And which station am I building a model of? Well, there could only be one, really. My life will probably end building Leamington Spa, the place that inspired me all those years ago.
Journey through our beginner's guide to British railway history at channel4.com/history. Next week, the history-making machine is the Flying Fortress, the B-17, as we take off with a new series of battle stations at 5:30. Coming up next tonight, a motorised rowing boat is the Scrap Heap Challenge.
Ah! existed a nation spawned from myth, strength, and power. Many